Ah, hi YouTube. How are you going? Well, today we're going to be looking at glide ratios. Which aircraft has the best glide ratio in the world? How do birds compare? Are they even close to what a real glider can do? What about commercial jetliners? How far will it glide if your engine stops? Well, we're going to cover all that right now. All right, so let's have a look at parachutes to start with. They have a glide ratio of 3 to 1. I've drawn that here in this little triangle. So what does that mean? That means if you're, say, at 5,000 feet, you can glide 3 times that distance, 15,000 feet, horizontally. If you're at 5,000 feet, that means you could glide, well, roughly 4.5 kilometers, 2.8 miles. So, you know, that's not too bad. Whatever you are height-wise, you can go 3 times the horizontal distance. Let's continue, shall we? Helicopter. Auto rotation. So imagine the power goes out on your helicopter. How far can it glide while auto rotating? And the answer is 4 to 1. So more than a parachute. That's good. Gives you a bit more options about where you're going to touch down on the ground. Next up, we have the space shuttle. 4.5 to 1. They have the little advantage, they're starting at 150,000 feet when they sort of start slowing down and begin their glide into the atmosphere. So you can imagine from 150,000 feet at 4.5 to 1, you've got a lot of range. Next up, a Cessna. So your engine goes out on your little Cessna, how far can you glide? And the answer is 8 to 1. So for every 1,000 feet you've got, you can glide 8,000 feet horizontally. Paraglider. Now we're starting to get into glider territory. 11.3 to 1 is sort of a good paraglider. So that actually gives you the ability to go from one place to another. You still need a decent amount of height to do it. You can get from one thermal to another, say, if you have 5,000 feet, you can glide to the next one. And you start to see this angle starts to get pretty shallow. Next up, we have the Boeing 767-200. This is the Gimli glider, and it was roughly estimated to glide about 12 to 1. This is where both engines crapped out, and it had to glide and reach this little airfield. And of course, it had the advantage that it was starting at 40,000 feet, which is 146 kilometers of glide it had, about 90 miles. So although the glide ratio on an airliner isn't that great, you're normally starting from a nice high altitude, so you can still get a decent distance, 100 kilometers in any direction. So hang gliders, 16 to 1 for a hang glider. Now we're getting somewhere. That starts to give you a lot of options as to where you go for the altitude you've got. What's next? Dreamliner. 787. So this is a modern airliner, much more modern than the Boeing 767, and the glide ratio of them, assuming both engines stop, is roughly 20 to 1. That's actually starting to get pretty good. That's, look at that little, look at that angle there, that's getting pretty shallow. Now we're starting to get into the territory of some of the best birds that can glide, and an albatross has a glide ratio of roughly 23 to 1. It's got one of the biggest wingspans. I'm not sure if this is the best gliding bird, but it's got to be up there. That is as good as nature can get, 23 to 1, roughly. We haven't reached any real gliders yet, but here's our first one, the PW5. PW5 is a low-performance glider. It's something that, you know, we often send newer pilots up in, and it's doesn't have great range, but it's nice and easy to fly, and you can land it in a paddock easily, which is good because it's only got a glide ratio of 32 to 1, which is actually very good compared to all the non-glider aircraft, much better than a hang glider or paraglider. So there we go. Now we're starting to see a bit more of a distance on that little triangle there. What's next? DG300. So this is the glider I had previously before my current glider. and it's what I'd call a medium performance glider. It's got a maximum glide ratio of 42 to 1. So that's starting to get somewhere as well. You can see it's a bit of a step up from the PW5 there. You know, some days that extra bit of distance you can glide really matters. Next up, we've got my own current glider in its 15 meter short wing configuration of 15 meters. So that's 43 to 1. Not much better than the DG300. However, there's a few things at play here. The DG300 is a non-flapped glider, which means you can't change the shape of the wing while you're flying. Whereas the Ventus is a flapped glider, suddenly can glide a lot further at higher speeds. So it's not just about the maximum glide ratio, it's also about how fast you can glide and still get a decent glide ratio. Okay, now we're going to put my big wings on. 18 meters. And this is leaps it up to a 49 to 1 glide ratio, which is pretty awesome. So let's zoom out there so we can see that one. So you can see we've got another step up in distance we can glide. And just to put that in perspective, if you're at 5,000 feet, you can glide 74 kilometers before you hit the ground, or 46 miles. Now obviously, we don't just glide until we hit the ground. You actually need to stop at around 800 feet above the ground to be able to do a circuit and a nice safe landing. So you would need to be able to glide 74 kilometers, you'd really need to be starting at say 6,000 feet rather than 5,000 feet. So this is a 1987 glider. What happens when we step it forward? Here we are now looking at a JS3 18 meter glider. This is a state-of-the-art glider, 55 to 1. So again, it's another step up in glide distance. Not a huge difference from my glider, but again, you'll be able to do much better glide ratios at higher speeds. So for me to do 49 to 1, I have to be going about 55 knots. Whereas the JS3 will probably get 49 to 1 at 70 knots or so, 65 knots. So for the same speed, the much newer glider can do the same glide performance. And if it's desperate and slows down, it can go 55 to 1. But we're still not even close to what the maximum glide ratio is for a glider. Let's keep on going, shall we? The Ash 26 meter wingspan glider can perform 60 to 1. So that is basically just making a nice long wing. You get a better glide ratio. That's getting pretty good. You can cover some serious distance. But that is not the best glider you can get. All right, so last up, we have the best glider in the world, and that is the Concordia, with a 28 meter wingspan. Just ginormous. 75 to 1 glide ratio. Put that in perspective, if this glider is at 5,000 feet, it can glide 112 kilometers. That is insane. 72 miles. I have to zoom out here to be able to put it on the chart. That is the angles we are dealing with. They are so fine. Unbelievable. That is the best known glider or machine or aircraft or animal or bird ever to fly. So 75 to 1 is the peak of where we're at the moment. And it's theorized we could even go a bit higher than that. So the question is, why doesn't everyone have a 28 meter wingspan? The reality is, it makes your glider slower to roll. Shorter the wings, the faster you can roll. Take a jet fighter, for example, really fast roll. My glider, I demonstrated, 15 meter versus 18 meter wingspan makes a difference to how fast it rolls. So imagine adding even more meters on the end. It slows it down even more. So, there's a happy sweet spot of around 15 to 18 meter wingspan. Gives you good maneuverability, but you can still get some awesome glides. The other big factor with much bigger wings comes much bigger cost. So that Concordia glider was a custom-made one-off glider. it would have cost hundreds of thousands of dollars, if not towards millions of dollars, to get that built. Whereas the 15, 18 meter gliders, they're a lot more standard. They come off a production line. They're still handmade, but a lot cheaper. And there's literally a lot less material in the wing, a lot less painting, a lot less work. So giant wings are not necessarily always a good thing. Well, I hope you've enjoyed that. Give us a like if you have. It really helps the channel if you do. And we'll catch you next time.